Welcome to VIRCH. I'm Dana Black, and this is The Table, a new inclusive and progressive Christian community in North County, San Diego. Thanks for joining us today, and we look forward to continuing this journey with you. For today's VIRCH, Reverend Chelsea and I have a conversation with Victoria Tihfon, one of our launch team members. She'll share her journey, and she really opens up in a vulnerable and authentic way to share with us how she has wrestled and struggled with the church and with God in her life. I know that I identified with her story, and my guess is some of you may as well. Not only does she share this wrestling, which you'll hear in the scripture, so make sure you listen to it as we share it later on, but she also shares not feeling worthy enough or good enough to be in church or to be in a relationship with God. Again, I know, I've been there, I've felt that too, and I'm wondering if some of you have also felt that you were unworthy or not good enough to be in relationship with God or to be in a Christian worship experience. Reverend Chelsea and I want to remind you that you are beloved, you are God's beloved child, and we hope that you hear that today through our conversation. You don't have to be an A-plus Christian. You always have a seat here, and God always has a seat for you at the table. Before we start, I again want to come in and invite you to just center yourself in this space. Forget about the noise and the distraction that's going on around you, and be present. Be present with yourself in this time. Be present with maybe those that you're sharing the space with. And most importantly, be present with God. And so with that, I have found that if I can just take two deep cleansing breaths using a count of three just kind of settles me into the space and the moment to really create that intentionality. So I'm going to invite you now to just gently close your eyes, and we'll go ahead and inhale and exhale on a count of three. Beginning, inhale, one, two, three, exhale, one, two, three. And once again, inhaling, one, two, three, exhaling, one, two, three. And maybe with your eyes still gently closed, just inviting God into this space, quietly saying, Lord, here I am. I'm listening. Your servant is here listening. Please speak. Now maybe gently reopen your eyes. And once again, I just want to thank you for sharing this time with us. And we look forward to hearing Victoria's story.
Stuck in reverse. is to watch you. And lights will guide you home and ignite your bones. And I will try to fix you.
Scripture comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 32, verses 22 to 31. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip.
We are here with another VIRCH episode with one of our launch team members, Victoria. We're so grateful that you are here with us. We're trying to think of how long we've known each other, working and otherwise, for a while now. But this has really been a different kind of experience as we've gotten to learn a little bit about your background and your family and your faith journey. And we're just really grateful that you are decided to take this on and share with our audience in such a vulnerable way. It's really something that's brave and courageous, and we're grateful for it. So we're glad to have you with us today. How we start all of these is just tell us a little bit about your background, you know, about your childhood, about what your thoughts on God and the church, and kind of what led you to this place you are right now.
Thank you, Chelsea and Dana. Thank you, ladies, for having me. I was trying to think last night about how long we've known each other. I know I've worked here for 5 years, but I knew you before I worked here, kind of off and on. And I know Dana for a while because of our mom's group. And so I'm just happy to be here chatting with you ladies for this experience. So I'll just get started. Growing up, I definitely had religion in my life. It was in various ways, going to church or visiting my grandparents, we would go to church, or I went to vacation Bible school or things like that. I definitely had religion. My grandfather is an ordained elder in the Methodist church, and he holds a master's degree in theology. So he's a very religious man. So my dad came from a go to church every single Sunday kind of a family. And my mom's family was very Irish, and so they were Catholic. When she was younger, she was a practicing Catholic, and I think both my parents kind of got away from religion a little bit in their early adulthood, you know, kind of like most people do. But they started having kids very young. They had three kids before they were 23 years old, and so I think having children kind of made them reconsider going back to church. There probably was some pressure from my grandparents for them to take their children to church, as they were very religious people themselves. And so we would go to church, and sometimes it would be very important and sometimes it would be not so important. We lived in a really small town, so there weren't a lot of churches to choose from. I remember going to a particular church, and like my parents would get upset with the church or with the pastor. And there would be like, you know, adult conversations that I probably wasn't supposed to be listening to in the car ride home about, we're not going back there and we're upset. And, you know, maybe we would stop for a while, or we would look for a different church, or, you know, church would be just a little less important for a while. And then, you know, at a certain point in time, it would come back to be more important. I'm not sure if anyone else has like experiences like that.
I was going to say, I had a very similar experience. Growing up in a small town, not a lot of church options, was United Methodist. But I remember there were moments where my mom and dad, or my mom or someone, was upset with, I don't know, the pastor or the leadership or whatever. And all of a sudden we transitioned to another church. Eventually we'd always come back to the Methodist church, but there was, and I never quite understood exactly why. And so I do think it creates kind of it's an imprint in your mind as a child when you're growing up in it, for sure. So I totally get that.
Right. And, you know, if you don't have very many memories, but you do remember these kind of odd things, and you don't have an explanation for why, I think it kind of sits with you a little bit longer. So as a kid, I was a very well-behaved kid. I was like a parent's dream, if you will. And I cared a lot about my parents being happy with me, or, you know, adults being happy with me, or just being a good kid. It was something that I cared about a lot. So I knew kind of what to say and when to say it and how to say it, and could recite things, you know, when I was told to, and seemingly was getting everything that I was supposed to be getting. But internally, I was actually really conflicted with a lot of the information that I was getting. You know, logical things didn't make sense to me. Even as a kid, I didn't believe in like Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny. I knew better than to like say that. In my household, if you didn't believe in Santa, you didn't get presents. So I knew not to say that I didn't believe in Santa. And I kind of had a similar feeling for God and for the Bible, and for parts of that is that I don't know that I necessarily believed that a virgin could have a baby, or that, you know, the story of Noah's Ark could happen, or that some of these other really challenging stories that didn't make sense, they didn't really have a place in my head. And so while it may have appeared like I was getting it and going along with the flow, I kind of let the information just slide right out. And I was conflicted about it. At the same time, I had really good experiences in conversations with my grandfather, who is a very religious man, and he always preached about God being love and how God will love you no matter what you do. And he's very compassionate and caring, and he's done all of these amazing things. And so I know that there's some truth to what he's saying. I know that he studied it. I know that he feels it. He believes it wholeheartedly. And I can't deny that. You know, so some things did stick with me that he taught me about God being love, or prayer stuck with me. I always kind of prayed in my head, even when I wasn't going to church or or things like that. Prayer just stuck with me. Even if I didn't know what to say in a prayer when we were kids, we had to pray like at dinner and stuff. So I had like a go-to prayer in my head. I still have it in my head. It's a pretty good prayer, I think, for a kid. But, you know, when you can't think of anything or you're just like not sure what to say, I would be good to go to my go-to prayer, even into my adult life.
I don't think that that is uncommon at all to have that experience. I think that there's lots of folks growing up and they don't feel like there's space for them to, as children, to ask these questions. You know, was Noah's Ark real? Was, you know, did God flood the whole entire earth? And it's unfortunate that we don't create those spaces, but I think this is a very normal experience, certainly.
For sure. For sure. And I think that that is a part of it too, is that nobody asked me like, hey, do you believe that? What do you think about that? Yeah. It was just, you know, kind of I understood that I was to believe what I was told kind of, and, you know, recite it back in certain ways. And so it was kind of like a private rebellion a little bit that I was having in my head as a kid who wanted to be well-behaved and do the right thing and stuff. But in my head, it was definitely conflicting. So that was essentially my childhood, you know, living under my parents' roof, experience with religion and with God.
So we just heard about your childhood, and some of the things that resonated for me or that stood out for me was hearing about this child that so desperately wanted approval and wanted to please her family and her authority figures. And so doing that, you tried to check all the boxes, right? Check with her check mark. But yet internally you're struggling. There's things that don't make sense. You're wrestling with questions and they're kind of left unanswered, and it causes conflict. I mean, it causes like, why is this? What is this God thing if it's really just about pleasing my parents? And now you're getting ready to transition into college as a young adult, which is a transformative time. And so it's a transformative time. So can you share a little bit about how that experience took you?
Sure. So you're right. I went from this well-behaved, straight A, you know, student who cared a lot about making people happy. And then you get to college, and I went to Cal State Monterey Bay. It was like 4 hours away from home. And it was like the rules were all different. I didn't have my parents to tell me, no, don't do this, or not even to tell me no, but to know what I was doing. You know, your friends and the people you're hanging out with, they don't give a shit if you're going to class or if you're partying every night. And so, you know, that's kind of what I was doing. I was going along with the flow of the rest of the kids, and I was partying and I was having an excellent time. And God and church were probably the furthest things from my mind, you know, with the exception of like a prayer here and there. But then even when I did think about, you know, going to church, there's this thought of are you worthy? Or are you worthy of being in church? Are these people going to want you sitting amongst them if they knew what you were doing, you know, on a Saturday night, per se? You know, or would they want you sitting with them on Sunday morning if they knew where you were on Saturday night? And that conflict,
that's such a common feeling. Okay. Like, yeah. I think that people just feel like that. You know, I know when I was in college, like, I even tried to get up and go to church, and I still felt like, if they knew what I was doing, like, they would send me right back, you know? I think that's a super common feeling, right? Especially in that young adulthood when you're really trying to figure out who you are, and you have finally have the freedom to decide who you are.
Right. You're able to do all of whatever it is that you want to do. And so I didn't want to then put on a fake face and go sit in church and act like I was a well-behaved, you know, straight A student when that literally was not the case. And so for me, I let college kind of last for years and years and years. I bounced around from college to college. I was following a boy kind of immaturely and, you know, in my naivety, was following a boy who took me, I don't know how to say this part. Honestly, I feel so stupid about it. I'm sorry. We're going to have to start over.
I don't even know if we do. I think that it's just, this is like the truth of what life looks like, right? Like this is it.
This is it. I mean, it goes back to, I mean, we've all, you know, here I have a similar experience. We've talked about it, Victoria, 26 years old, you know, before 21, got married, moved 3,000 miles away to go through a very tumultuous divorce at 26. So I get it. Like, I get what you're saying.
Okay. So I was following a guy, and it didn't work out, of course. And so I ended up, back at home. My mom let me move back home, and, this wasn't like a rejoice, you're coming home sort of an experience, but more like a tail between your legs, back at home after, you know, spending so many years at college with not much to show for it. And just kind of some bad hobbies picked up along the way, and, you know, thinking things were going to get better, hoping things were going to get better, but they didn't really. We were living in Fresno at the time, and they actually got kind of worse. And so my grandmother then invited my mom and I to move down to San Diego, and she invited us to move in with her, and she has an awesome house near the beach. It seemed like just this amazing offer. We couldn't say no. And so, you know, we packed up, we got out of town, and we came down to San Diego. Yay. Again, hoping for a fresh start, again, hoping that things would get better and that, you know, life would just start kind of piecing together and things would come together. And that didn't happen either. Things took a turn and they got even worse for me. I continued to make bad choices. I continued to, you know, not have the best priorities in my life. And so, so much so that at age 26, I found myself and my fiance at the time in the hospital. We were in the emergency room in the middle of the night. I had to go. I wasn't feeling well. And I learned that I was in complete liver failure at age 26. They immediately admitted me to the hospital. And little did I know I would spend like over 8 weeks in hospital care. And it was, you know, from a hospital room. And then I had to go to like a rehabilitation. And I basically sat in a hospital bed with, you know, people around me older and dying and just being miserable. And, you know, the amount of depression that comes from spending 8 weeks in a hospital is just awful. I remember thinking multiple times, like, I can't do this. I can't continue this way anymore. And so basically, you know, at age 26, I was at like the low of the low, as low as you can essentially get. And not sure if I was going to get out of the hospital, not sure if I was going to get better. Not sure, you know, if my fiance was going to become my husband, not sure, you know, if people were going to stick around, with me for this sort of like long trek, back to reality, back to some sort of normalcy. And so, I think often, you know, during times like that, people, they find themselves turning to God. They find God in those times. And, you know, for a lot of people, God brings them out of, you know, these slumps. And I wish I could say that was a story for me. I wish I could say I found God in the hospital and now, you know, it's this miraculous change, but that really wasn't the truth. I wasn't looking for God. And if he was looking for me, I wasn't probably willing to recognize that. I think that people would give me advice of like, you know, talk to your pastor, go to church, read your Bible. And it didn't resonate with me. I didn't think that I was still, you know, worthy of that kind of love or of that kind of salvation. I was still struggling with who I was. I was struggling with anybody finding out who I was. I was struggling to be a better person or not knowing if I could be a better person. And so, you know, the idea of walking into a church and having everyone immediately be able to tell, like, what is, something's wrong with this girl, you know, something's off, is she okay? I couldn't bear to put myself in a situation like that.
So I hear you telling your story, you know, you were feeling like at this point in your life, you were at rock bottom. There is nowhere lower that you can go. And people are trying to be helpful, give you advice saying, you know, go to church or talk to a pastor. And I really just wanted to pause for a moment and say, you know, God is not confined to the walls of a church or confined to people that are ordained. God is everywhere. And we can experience God in anybody and in any place. God is just that expansive. And I think that's really important to remind people about that. But sounding like in your experience, that maybe God wasn't in the church building for you or in ordained pastors.
Well, and honestly, you're right. And reflecting back, and of course, when we reflect, you know, we see things a lot clearer. Hindsight is 20/20. And I would say that I didn't think that God was involved in all of these different ways. But when you asked me to do this VIRCH, you asked me to pick worship music also. And it was another like panic, like what worship music am I going to pick? I don't know any worship music. I don't listen to it. I tend to listen to like rap and hip hop in the car. That's probably not appropriate. Maybe it is. I don't know. Maybe the next VIRCH will choose something else. Anyways, I was able to just kind of go through and think about songs that were really meaningful in my life. And we were all able to hear Talip and Sarah perform Coldplay's song, Fix You. I'm a huge Coldplay fan, just a little side note. I have an amazing experience. I took like a road trip with friends to go see Coldplay in Oregon. We drove overnight and saw them and like just amazing, had amazing time. So they're very like held a very special place in my heart. And one of my favorite songs of theirs is a song called Fix You. And this song is kind of, you know, been a part of my life for a long time. It's not necessarily a religious song, but it's a song about somebody that's definitely going through some shit. They're going through tough times. You know, you try your best, but you don't succeed. You love someone, but it goes to waste. You know, tears are streaming down your face. This is like somebody going through some stuff. And then the song says that lights will guide you home and I will try to fix you. And even not thinking about this song in any sort of religious capacity, but just thinking about it as a favorite song, I always felt like there was this, you know, higher power. Somebody's going to come. And lights are going to guide me home and it'll be okay. And, you know, gently, fix me, if you will. You know, and maybe if I'm not feeling like that's happening right now, it's like, I'm just not looking for it or it's not the right time. And I kind of look back at these times in my life, about, you know, kind of being on a path that wasn't the best path and then being gently guided to a little bit better of a path. And so I think it's also important to mention like the gentleness and like the allure of lights guiding you home as opposed to like someone telling you need to do this or you need like
pushing you.
If you know me, I'm like stubborn, strong-willed. If you ask my husband and somebody's like, Victoria, you need to think like this. I mean, my knee-jerk reaction is like, no, I'll think how I want to think, you know? So in order to change my mind about things, it takes somebody's gentle kind of, I have to come to terms with it on my own. And so this song really, kind of illuminates that for me by just having like a trust that, you know, something higher than yourself will guide you home and kind of fix all of your screw ups that you've, you know, kind of gathered throughout your life.
I have to tell you that now when I hear that song, it is a holy song. Like when you explained it, I was just like, this song is so spirit. Like I totally understand why you chose it. And especially in light of what you're telling us, you know, this journey and pathway. And now you're in the, like you were just sharing, in this rock bottom place, but you have these lights that are gently leading you. And I'm wondering if you could just share a little bit about like, what were those lights? Who were those lights that maybe now retrospect you could see as God, but maybe not at the time, but you had these people, right?
Definitely. And throughout my life, I've noticed there's always somebody that knows how to talk to me, you know, specifically to me, and how to kind of guide me back to a right path when I'm kind of have gone astray. And so when my, like the first light is like a warm and like welcoming and loving light of my mom, who allowed me to come home kind of tail between my legs, and she didn't, you know, judge me or give me a hard time or you know, make me follow rules or anything. She just welcomed me home and, you know, made me feel like it was going to be okay. And then you have like a blinged out, fabulous, always matching light of my Jima, if you've ever met my Jima. And she allowed me to come to her home. She gave me a place to stay. She gave me countless, you know, connections for jobs. She's helped me in just countless ways, always been a light. She would be like a rhinestone light, maybe like a sparkly blinged out light.
Yes.
Totally blinged out light.
Yeah. And then, you know, my husband is a very calm, stable, you know, strong presence, something that I find that I need. It helps like ground me a lot. And, he was with me through times that you don't, he didn't have to stick around. And he chose to, and I can't help but consider that maybe that was God sending himself through other people in a way that I could recognize it, you know, at the time, in a way that I was willing to hear it, given, you know, my circumstances at the time. And so that's not to say that, like, you know, I figured it out or anything like that, but that maybe I'm just open to that idea and open to reflecting on some of these ideas. You know, you asking me to do this VIRCH has kind of helped me to reflect, giving me a reason to reflect, and then also just kind of putting words to what's happened, the process that's taken place kind of in my life.
So. Yeah, I think God does actively use humans to be guiding lights right here, to bring God's kingdom right here. And but I was wondering, like, how did you get to this point? We've talked about you being a part of VIRCH, a part of our launch team. You know, you worked for the church for many years.
Mm-hmm. Still do work for the church.
You still do work for the church. That's right. You still do work for the church. But yet here you are, and you're interested in engaging more at a deeper relationship, at a deeper place. What got you there? Like, how did you get to this moment?
Sure. So about 5 years ago, I started working at the church, and that was a GMA connection. This is one of GMA's connections. This is her church. And I love working for the church. I love the community. I love the people. And I've been asked a number of times, you know, why don't you join the church? And I've considered it a few times, but I don't think that I kind of figured out all of those conflictions in my head or felt like I figured them out enough to be able to stand up in front of, you know, people and say, I believe this, you know, or take membership vows. Or I don't think I ever got to a place where that would be honest for me. And so I never really considered it much past that. I enjoy coming to church. People are amazing when I'm here. They're so friendly. Like, there's just some parts of it that you can't get anywhere else, this community of people. So I had considered it, you know, when I first started working here, but it just didn't really sink home. And then just by chance, Chelsea and I got pregnant around the same time. And I had my daughter, Ireland, and Chelsea was pregnant a few months later. And I realized immediately that I just needed someone to talk to about what I was going through and how, and like, am I doing this right? Or, you know, I'm just feeling overwhelmed or all of these things. I realized that I needed, you know, a community to be a mom in. I had never been a mom before. Chelsea really decided to start a mom's group, and she allowed me to help her start it.
Thank you.
We met other moms, and not that the conversation was ever very like religious, but our relationships really grew, and you know, kind of right timing, right place. Chelsea had discussed starting a new worship service that was inclusive of all sorts of people, no matter, you know, if you believe in God, if you don't believe in God, if you, you know, go to church every Sunday, if you want to come once a year, if you're poor, if you're rich, if you're, you know, homeless, if you're an alcoholic, like, it just really would be accepting and inviting of all, and of all people to come exactly how they were, and not to, like, get dressed up and put on, you know, your Sunday best and put on a happy face for an hour, and act like everything is great in your life, but more of a place to like come and be yourself and do life with other people. Mm-hmm. And so I think having, you know, a daughter, having a child, it opened up my eyes to even wanting something like that for myself. But more importantly, I think I wanted something like that for her. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, as a parent, you just want to give your kid absolutely everything that they want, that they need, that they don't want. You just want to give them, and you want to be like the best provider. And so, you know, these questions came up of what are we going to tell our daughter about God, or what are we going to go to church, or, and I think that there's just these key points that you would miss out if you just never had church in your life as a child, you know, these things that you learn about community, about caring for other people, about, you know, looking in on others, about God's love, these, you know, just lots of great things that you might miss out on if I decided to not make religion a part of my daughter's life.
So Victoria, you picked another interesting song for your Verge, Zion by Lauryn Hill, which we'll hear from Talip in just a minute. But I was wondering if you could just explain a little bit about why you chose that song also.
Sure. So this song is special to me. This whole album, this is The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill, is a very special, I would say, album to me as a kid. I had it on cassette tape, listened to it religiously front and back, read the lyrics. Interestingly enough, I always heard this song, To Zion, and I always thought it was a religious song. I thought it was a song about Lauryn Hill, you know, wanting to get back closer with God, and, you know, how she'll find joy, when she is in Zion. And I was assuming that Zion was synonymous with heaven, and not really realizing the context of it. So I went back when we did this Virch and read, why she wrote this song. And this song was actually to her firstborn child, whose name is Zion. And she wrote it for him because she was an up-and-coming artist, essentially, who was being told, don't have a baby, keep doing what you're doing, you know, make your money, that kind of thing. And she had to kind of reflect on what was important to her. She was very young, and so she decided to have her son, obviously, and she is just overjoyed. He's like the light of her life, and I feel like that really hits home for me with Ireland. When I got pregnant, I wasn't supposed to get pregnant. I wasn't supposed to be able to have a kid necessarily, because of medical problems. And so a lot of the time I was kind of being told, I was being watched very closely, and I was almost being told, maybe this isn't a good idea. You know, if anything goes wrong with your health, we might have to reconsider. So it was like a stressful time also. And then I have this child who is just amazing. If you've ever seen Ireland, she walks in the room and she lights up the room, and she is, you know, full of life. She's full of energy. You know, for some reason, you know, she picked me to be her mom. And I feel like in the song, it talks about, you know, she's thanking her son Zion for choosing her. And she talks about how a gift so great is only one God could create. And she's reminded every time she sees his face. And not that I would put those exact words to my child, but I think that that resonates with me, because I don't know how on earth or what I did to deserve this amazing child, you know, a gift so great. But I'm just like filled with joy from her. She's like the joy of my world. And it talks about that in the song too. So that's why I picked that Lauryn Hill song.
And we can,
now that we're all crying,
I was gonna say, we can see that joy right here. I mean, what a gift. I love it. I loved, I actually love both of the songs you picked, and there was so much meaning to them. And Chelsea's already said this. I mean, we see them as secular songs, but oh my heavens, the spirituality and the love that is just flowing through them right? Mm-hmm. It just gives you a different perspective on the music selection.
Definitely.
So, you know, with that, I mean, this has just been a very powerful conversation for me. A lot of what you're, you know, I resonate with a lot of what you said, but we did want to also share with those that are watching just how you came up with the scripture or what the story is behind the scripture. And I, if you could just share that with us.
Sure. So that was another hard thing. Chelsea was like, Victoria, I need you to pick a scripture. And I was like, crap. I know none. I know no scriptures, I don't think. And that's not true. I look at scriptures all the time. I'm looking at bulletins. But I drew a blank. And Chelsea had suggested maybe just doing some research. And so I Googled scriptures related to wrestling with God. And you literally could not get away from the story about Jacob wrestling with the angel, I think it was, or with somebody, you know, all night long. And so I thought that was interesting. And I read more about Jacob. And then I was like, I don't want to be Jacob. Jacob did not seem to be that great of a guy. He didn't always do nice things. He was like, he betrayed his sister, I think. And, you know, he wasn't the best guy. And so I was looking for other stories, any other story, and just kind of searching the internet. And I came across another story about Jacob, where someone describes that message, and what they said really resonated with me and is why I actually did end up picking the scripture with Jacob. And what they said was that Jacob had, you know, plenty of examples of faith in his life on how to be a faithful person, on how to, you know, follow God and like what one should do. And, you know, if you read about him, he obviously was not doing those things. But what he really needed was this like personal hands-on is really what he got, you know, approach to what it means to be blessed by God, what it means to be loved by God, to follow God. And he wasn't going to take basically like any other person's example of that. He wanted his own example. He wanted his own unique experience. And I think that that is definitely true for me. I don't want to necessarily hear how to be a follower of God or how to be faithful or how to be religious or, you know, a good Christian. I want to know for myself. I want to feel like it's not something I have to think about. It's like something that's coming from, you know, inside. And I don't think that I would fake that any other way. I'd have to really, like Jacob, I'd have to have that hands-on or continue to get those hands-on experiences, those approaches to really to create a lasting and a meaningful relationship with God.
Amen. So that's the message right there.
An authentic faith, right? The one that you really is real for you. And that's part of what your story is. It's like the wrestling through, is this real for me? How can I make sense of this in my own life? And so I think you've shared so much of that with just your story and your songs and the people in your life and this scripture. And so I just want to thank you, Victoria. This was like such a vulnerable, honest conversation. And it takes a lot of courage to share your story the way that you did. And so I know that our listeners will be blessed in hearing it, that they will be inspired. And so I just want to really thank you for taking the time.
Well, thank you for listening.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Unsure of what the balance held, that touched my belly, overwhelmed by what I had been chosen to perform. But then an angel came one day, told me to kneel down and pray, for unto me a man child would be born. Oh, this crazy circumstance, I knew his life deserved a chance, but everybody told me to be smart. Look at your career, they said, baby, won't you use your head? But instead I chose to use my heart. Now the joy of my world nothing more than to wait there at Zion's door. I've never been in love like this before. Now let me pray to keep you from the perils that will surely come. See, life for you, my prince, has just begun. And I thank you for choosing me to come through into life to be a beautiful reflection of his grace. For I know that a gift so great is only one that God can create. And I'm reminded every time I see your face that the joy of my world is in Zion. Now the joy of my world is in Zion. Now the joy of my world is in
yourself wrestling with God from time to time. Maybe you are wrestling with God right now. I want to remind you that this is a good thing. This means that you are participating in your faith and making it real for you. And the good news is that we get to do this work together. So as we go and do this work together, may you be reminded that the love of God goes with you now and always. Amen.
At this table, at this table.